Thank you, Sergio. Okay. All right. We will carry on, and we are going to proceed with council member reports, appointments, and future agenda items. I will start to my right. I see council member Craig in the distance.
I have two appointments to the Youth Advisory Commission. Evan Haro. Evan is 13 years old, will be attending Palma High School next year. He his special qualifications for the commission is that he's hardworking, dedicated, and wants to help voice new ideas. So I'm very excited to welcome Evan to the Youth Advisory Commission. And also Ron Lee. Ron is in 12th grade. He's applying to UC Berkeley. He was the treasurer of the California Scholarship Federation, and he's also on the cross-country team. He attends Salinas High School, so excited to appoint both of them. Couple of things, wanted to just address Councilman McShane, or Mayor Pro Tem McShane, had requested a Monterey County Convention and Visitors Bureau update. It's my understanding that they are on the docket, Councilman McShane, that Monterey County Convention and Visitors Bureau is on the docket for a presentation. So their meeting has been canceled for October, but they will be reconvening in November. I wanted to let you know so that you didn't keep reminding us. Additionally, just a quick note and a kudos to Mayor Pro Tem McShane as well for this past weekend for Salinas Valley Food and Wine. Unbelievable event, thousands of people in Old Town, very well run, and one of the brainchild ideas of Steve McShane. So great job on that. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Kimberly. Councilmember Barrera.
Yes, and congratulations, Councilmember McShane. That was a wonderful event. And during the same time, Caminos del Arte, thanks to Ms. Avalos, Nicolasa Avalos, they had over 5,000 people at Closter Park at the same time. And they had a really nice event with a lot of the young people. Also, to whoever's in charge of Laurel Extension with the cleanup, the shrubs are in the way of the people that are riding their bicycles, people are having a difficult time walking through there, so whoever can take care of that. It looks like the street sweeper hasn't gone through there for a while as well. So we need to take care of that because it's dangerous. The bike riders have to go onto the street because the bushes are coming out from the little trail there. Also, Mr. City Manager, I'd like to request an update as soon as possible, please, on the Church of the Nazarene. There's a lot of conversation about this building, and I would like to see where we're at so we can see where we go from here. Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Tony. Gloria.
On that note, yes, a lot of phone calls that are we gonna lease it? What are we gonna do with it? So I agree, we need an update so we can be able to respond. Couple of things, I wanna give kudos to Parks and Rec, Elizabeth, Christian, Rudy Rodriguez. Great event, the Harvest Fall Festival at Hebron Heights. We had a lot of kids there, like always, and Rudy and the staff, they made tacos de carne asada, and it was good. So the kids had a wonderful time, so I was there. Also, I want to thank COPA and St. George Episcopal Church because they held a peace march that started from Alvin Drive all the way to Madonna, and they went through all the neighborhoods and they came back. So that was a really well attended also peace march. Probably a couple hundred people were there. So again, and to all the pastors that attended. But this Thursday at Gavilan School on Lidwood, I am having a community meeting from 6 to 7 at El Gavilan School on safety issues, neighborhood watch, and resources. So whoever is listening and is in that area, I invite you to come to that meeting on that date. And Emmanuel Bilingual Baptist Church on Gardner, we're having a fall festival to try to discourage kids from going out in the streets and trick-or-treating because we're having this big fall get-together at our church. So also we invite the community from that area to come on October 31st. And that is it for me.
Thank you, Gloria. Hiya, Jill. Want in on this?
Yeah. If I could. Very quickly, two committee meetings that I attended this week, subcommittee meetings. One that's very interesting that might have some impacts on us is our legislative committee. We talked very briefly about the impacts of Proposition 30, whether it passes or fails, but what the impacts will be on the city. We'll get more information on that in a couple weeks. The sequestration in Washington, D.C. is something we're also interested in seeing how that's going to impact us as a city, certainly will impact the states. So couple things that we're on the legislative committee watching and keeping track of. Kimberly serves on that with me, and we met with our lobbyist in Sacramento yesterday, or he met with us here, and it was very interesting what's going on in both Sacramento and Washington, D.C., and how it's going to impact us. Right now, we know it impacts us because there's no money. So hopefully that will change. The other meeting I attended was the Future Growth Area meeting. We're looking forward to getting some big changes in terms of updating our traffic fee ordinances and some other exciting things that we'll be doing in the city. And I guess that will all eventually lead us to our general plan update, which is probably getting ready to be updated. And then the last thing, Jessica Wong, I am appointing her, tennis player, to our youth commission, and she will be a fabulous addition. She is from Alisal High. Thank you.
Thanks, Joe. So, Joe?
Just have a quick appointment. Damaris Serrato to the youth commission. She's a 15-year-old at Everett Alvarez High School.
Okay. Steven?
Yeah, a couple things on the Salinas Valley Food and Wine Festival. I'm glad to have so many council members that were able to come out and to support it. City manager, mayor was one of the food judges, and I know Jill was helpful in one of the nonprofits that had a booth there. That was really cool. To Elizabeth and to the city, the date for next year is set for October 19th. So I'll put the request in early, probably next week, for a resource fair and anything that the city can do to be out there. There were 7,000 folks that turned out, and there's a collection in front of the folks here of various articles. I put some copies at the back as well. And the one line that got my attention is the Monterey County Herald. That is predominantly the Peninsula paper, covered this very closely. And there's just a quick quote I want to read. Festival goers were impressed. Jill and Cameron Center of Pacific Grove said the festival had more and better offerings than the more established Monterey Wine Festival, which celebrated its 36th anniversary this year. The article goes on to focus on people from Carmel, Pacific Grove, and the Peninsula that came to Salinas and overcame the reputation that I think we all are too familiar with, that they would never come here because it's bullets and violence. So I don't need to belabor that too much, but altogether, the official count is just over 7,000, and all the store owners were very happy. I walked Gabalon today. I checked with several people on Alisal. No violence, no issues. People very, very happy. A lot of business was conducted, which is what we need. I want to pay special tribute to Mike Gardner. He was a great help. He was out there in full force. In fact, I caught him at the end of the day, and I said, Mike, how do you think this went? How long have you been working for the city? He said, 34 years. Have you ever seen anything like this? I asked Mike. He said, back in 1979, when the Como del Rodeo Parade was at its height, was there this kind of energy in Old Town? So I think it truly was something different. To Sheila Molinari, to Kelly McMillan, his staff, just great, great support from the city. And even the County of Monterey, the health department was very helpful, as this is a new event. And 18 months ago, it didn't exist. So just want to throw that out there. There's, again, these articles, and you can just check it out. A few other quick things. Like Councilwoman De La Rosa, there's a public safety meeting I have set for Villa Serra. It's a Los Olivos Riker Neighborhood Association meeting. That'll be on the 12th of November. I also want to ask the city manager for just a few possible future agenda items. I would like to, and I may have brought this up before, I can't remember, but the Monterey Bay National Marine Sanctuary. I sit as an alternate to that board, and you'd be amazed at the connection to the Salinas Valley and runoff and where things are going there. So that'd be a great talk. There's a new new cop in town, or whatever you want to, the top dog at CSUMB, Ocho, they call him, former undersecretary to the Secretary of Education under the Obama administration, is at CSU Monterey Bay, and he is really doing some heavy lifting at CSU Monterey Bay, so it'd be cool to have them come and give a talk. And when Mike Jones can be invited, I'd love to have a talk from our friends at California Water Service. You know, I don't know when the last time was we had the kind of a water report. They've got fancy reports and things that they put out, and I think that they should ring their bell a little bit. So, and I don't know if you guys saw in today's paper or not, but I want this picture framed and signed of the mayor. This is like so amazing. If you guys didn't see this, it's in today's Salinas, California. I'll pass it down. You just look so elated. It's a really good picture. You should get it framed, and it should be on your mantle. So anyhow, I just thought that was a good picture. So that's all I've got.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, I think, Steve. All right. Okay, couple of things. First of all, certainly let me echo the accolades that you are getting for the Salinas Valley Food and Wine Festival. Really well done, and I do appreciate Tony's comments. You know, two locales, over 10,000 people over the weekend. There's, you know, I'm a little rusty on my Steinbeck quotes, but I think there's one that give or take says something like, there's always something going on in Salinas. So I'll find it and see if we can dust that off and display it. I don't read the paper. I hear about the paper. And to Councilmember Craig's comments, it so happens that the Monterey County Convention and Visitors Bureau was in the House this past week. That the whole group of folks, their entire staff, and it was really very impressive, came over to Salinas mid-morning last Tuesday and had a walking tour of Old Town and some of our historic sites. And I heard there were reports of my lunchtime activities. For the record, there is no buffet at the Steinbeck House. What there is, though, was a group of folks from Monterey, and we had a terrific opportunity to exchange ideas on how the Monterey County Conventions Bureau can be more supportive of Salinas. The docents who are unfailingly proud of the work they do at the Steinbeck House, and they should be, had a chance to explain the history of the house. And so we had a very productive 3 or 4 hours before they went on to learn more about our ag and wine industries. So we're working to build that relationship, and I thought that was very constructive. Jill, I will, at no cost to the city, I will be in Washington on Tuesday building a to-do list for John O'Donnell, so anything that we need to make sure that they keep me off the streets and we make sure we've got good continuity for Salinas, please make sure, and I've already asked Ray to put a couple things on that, And then, Steve, the picture you're actually referring to, I'm honored to represent the city tomorrow up at San Francisco at a Future Farm Conference, and I will be speaking, and Salinas will come up more than once. So I'm looking forward to, who knows, even the Salinas Valley Wine and Food Festival may come up. So with that, it's clearly a busy group, and Steinbeck remains right. Something's always going on. All right, I know what it looks like, all right, with that, we are going to, I need my cheat sheet, I can't do this without it. Even after 6 years, I still need to see all my color codes here. All right, we are gonna do the consent resolution calendar. There are five items on the consent resolution. Would anyone on council like any of the five items pulled?
Four.
Jill, four. Public? Back to Jill.
Actually, Mayor, this is probably not even a question for you, Gary. It's more just mentioning to you, Mayor, when you're in San Francisco, going up to Washington, D.C., with the Intermodal Transit Center there's some federal grants for transit-oriented development. I think that we need to, Gary, keep those plans well, as in your words, right, dusted off and carry them with you, because those grants actually are available. That is some money that is available from Washington, okay, federal money. So be aware of that when you go up to D.C.
Good, yeah. Thank you right, for that.
And talk, okay, speak with John O'Donnell. Thanks.
I will do that. All right. All right, is there a motion to approve the calendar?
So move.
Second.
Councilmember Barrera?
Aye.
Councilmember Craig?
Aye.
Councilmember De La Rosa?
Aye.
Councilmember Lutz?
Aye.
Councilmember McShane?
Yes.
Councilmember Sanchez?
Yes.
Mayor Donahue?
Yep. All right, with that, we're going to do something we often do at a council meeting. We're going to consider stuff. And we're going to start with Matt Pressey, and he's going to talk about the budget.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor and members of City Council. Before you is a first quarter update. It includes year-end results of the prior year. It includes a look at our revenue and expenditures year-to-date for the first quarter, and some consideration of budget amendments for our operating and one-time funding for certain items using our carryover. So starting with the year-end results for FY 2011-12, this is a picture of our revenue numbers that came in and the distribution. This chart really homes in on exactly what happened. Starting at the top, property tax, we received $20.9 million. We had budgeted $20.75 million, so we came in 101% of our budget, and slightly less than last year, which is what we anticipated, approximately 0.6% decrease per the assessed roll. So this came in pretty much what we expected. Sales tax is up 101% to $21.85 million from the prior year of $20.1 million. That's a $1.7 million increase, 9%, which is very healthy for the rebound on that revenue item. Utility users tax is also up 4%, $385,000, and that's also healthy. Business license tax is pretty much flat from year to year, and we came in right exceeded our budget by 1%. Transient occupancy tax exceeded it by 6% and increased 6% from last year. So some good healthy trends there. Those are the top, pretty much the top five revenue items. Charges for services is a large revenue stream that went down about 2%, and mainly because of, for services the city supplies. So that pretty much was flat year over year. The revenue from other agency, on the other hand, that decreased 253%, excuse me, and that was a 27% decrease, and that related to the vehicle license fee that we collect, that the state collected, and that was eliminated and phased out, and in this year that we're in, it went to zero, so you'll see a decline there. But overall, revenue exceeded the prior year by about $2.7 million, or a 4% increase, and we came in pretty much right on budget at 101%. So a good strong year there. On the expenditure side, this is the general fund department budgets, and as you can see in the far right corner, percent spent, everybody, all the departments were within budget, and overall we came in at 2.17% under budget. We spent 97.83% of our $70 million general fund budget. So that is also good news. So jumping quickly to the slide 9, FY 2012-13 first quarter results, we have our adopted budget of 72.4 million, and for the first quarter we've received 11.6 million, 16%. If straight lining it, we would be at 27%. Really, the timing issue here is property tax, which is our second largest revenue source. Starting at the top, we've only received $104,000, and we get our big property tax remittance in December. So that's largely why we're only at 6%, 16%. But taking the significant revenue stream, sales tax, we're ahead of schedule there at 19% collected. Compared to last year, we're up $355,000, or a 9% increase from the prior year. So we're doing good there. Utility users tax, also we're we're slightly decreased from the prior year, but we're at 27% of the budget. And that's largely from a timing from some of the big utilities that haven't remitted yet. And business license tax, we're slightly ahead of schedule there, and 273 or 32% ahead of the prior year, which is very healthy. And franchise fee, we are basically at par with prior year, and there's actually a timing difference that isn't reflected there, where we're actually further ahead than what it reflects here. And then again, on the revenue from other agency, jumping third from the bottom, that is a 32% decrease, and that's also largely due to the motor vehicle license fee that the state discontinued funding it. They replaced it with other funding that historically we had already got. So net, we're down in that from the state. And charter services down, and that's reflective of the service demand on the city. So just jumping into a little more detail, sales tax, this is the major categories and sectors of sales tax, fuel and service stations and general consumer have been the largest, and those are ahead this year. The orange column is 2012 through the second quarter. The green is prior second quarter, 2011. So everything's up other than business and industry, which is down right now, and so that is lagging in its recovery. Property tax, our second biggest source, you can see the trend here going quite a ways back. The assessor's office did indicate a 5%, which that says, or a 0.5%, that says 0.7, so it's off. But the point here being we've had four years of consecutive declines, and this is the first where the assessed value has increased slightly at 0.5%. As far as our budgets for each department, first quarter, we have basically all the departments are on track and have engaged in operations first quarter for the year, and there's a variety of encumbrances that also are added to the percentage spent, even though the services haven't been received. But overall, we're at 22%, so off to a good start there. And monitoring our budget and trying to limit the spending where we can. So from the Measure V committee, they met back on the 11th of October, and we looked at their revenue. This slide is a picture of the revenue, and year over year, it's up 2.7%, which is, that's our budget. For the first quarter, we are ahead at 9.1%, so that is also positive. So at mid-year, there may be some additional allocation or requests that we'll bring back to the Measure V committee and to council on from an operating standpoint. We do have some capital items to consider. And then historically, we can see a good, healthy recovery. We're back to the $10 million mark next year, and this year we'll probably exceed $10 million. We're right at estimating 9.9, and we're ahead of schedule there, so that's good. From budget adjustments proposed, we have in the general fund, the first number in this slide, 357, was part of our balanced budget. We actually had a surplus of 357 that wasn't allocated, and we were informed, so the first ask, the 292,000, we were informed in August what our new rates would be for health insurance, and that statewide went up 9%. For our location, Midcoast, it actually went up 16%. So we need to add that cost in. This is citywide, and this is the general fund's portion, $992,000. So we're increasing our, proposing to increase our budget by that. And then there's some other, more of a cleanup items related to staffing, Public Works Department. We're requesting a change from a maintenance worker 3 to a 4, from a 2 to a 3. And then also our community safety program manager historically has had one salary. We're asking for a salary schedule for full range for that position, and it's already budgeted and not anticipated to need additional funding for that. So it's more of a cleanup. So that would leave us still balanced as far as our budget is concerned. So these are the operating adjustments. And this slide 17 is a reflects our carryover, basically on a cash basis, minusing our receipt payables and our encumbrances and capital items that roll over. So this is what's available at the beginning of this year as one-time funding. So the general fund had a carryover of $1.6 million, and Measure V had a carryover of $1.2 million, and largely has been carried over for a little while now. So the proposed one-time uses for the general fund is the top section. There's four items there. Safety gear, that's actually gear for five individuals in the fire department. That wasn't budgeted, so this is a one-time request. Cash advance to the California Welcome Center, so this is funding to keep them going for a 12-month period and until we continue to work on getting permanent funding. They already receive a half cent, and that is about 8,000. This would be an additional three. Funding for the police clerk position and police detective, these were frozen or defunded, and this was more of a cleanup related to the operating budget that was adopted. So this is a fix to fund those positions for the rest of the year. Those positions definitely were needed and shouldn't have been defunded. The police department hazardous materials survey study. This was related to asbestos, and funds were pulled from another area to get that project going, and this replenishes the cost of that. So this is more of an after the fact, and we're requesting approval of that those funds also, which occurred back in July. So from the Measure V standpoint, the Measure V committee is recommending to the City Council supporting these two items, the 50-50 sidewalk replacement test program. So it's seed money. It would be matched with another 150 from I believe it's gas tax funds, and this would go toward the residents paying 50% of a replacement of their sidewalks up to 2,500. And this was presented back in April, the concept based on the sidewalks committee recommendation, and so that was supported. And this sets the appropriation for that program. And then lastly, the Law Enforcement Operating Center, as indicated in the staff report, the federal government, FBI specifically, is not able to fund this the rent, and so this would make up the portion of the rent that they were planning on funding. Chief McMillan is available if there's further questions on that, but basically this would be is a one-time request, and the hope is to continue to move forward with the other agencies to get them to participate in some level of funding. And then lastly, we did update our five-year forecast, and we are actually at the next City Council meeting we will be coming back with more details related to the gap and some options as far as how to balance these budgets and prior to entering into and opening negotiations with the bargaining units, we will bring that forward and for council to give us direction on how to proceed there. So with that, I will open it up for any questions. Thank you.
All right, before we get started, we have a lengthy agenda ahead of us, so I remind council the goal will be we want to be in closed session on or about 6 o'clock. So with that in mind, and we have a couple more items, Councilmember McShane.
Yeah, just looking for more information and background on the LEOC. This was an area of great interest to me for some time, and I'm a believer, Mr. Mayor. I went through it, and you know, I saw the benefit of having numerous agencies working collaboratively, but I remember looking for even just a cocktail napkin, coming back from DC, something in writing that said the feds are gonna pick up the check. And it appears that may not be the case. Obviously, we're lucky enough to have more robust income due to sales tax. It's a little higher than we had thought. But if the other had happened, we would really be in a rough spot. And I think it's important that we prepare for that kind of a situation, because who knows what's gonna happen after November 6th. We could be bailed out, we could be two steps behind. So looking for just a little bit more detail on what's going on here and what the crystal ball tells us for the future, if there is crystal balls out there.
Yeah, I don't think the crystal balls are working lately. As you recall, the Law Enforcement Operations Center was a vision of Chief Featheroff, and the mayor and Chief Featheroff at that time worked very closely with state and federal partners. The original concept was this was going to be a state of California task force under the Bureau of Narcotic Enforcement. It was going to be funded by them, led by them, along with federal partners, and the FBI had agreed to pick up a rent, basically, for the building. Once BNE was defunded and eliminated, basically, as an agency, Chief Featheroff continued forward with the vision because he believed strongly in the power and the multiplier effect of working with our federal and state and other local partners. So we marched forward. The city basically fronted some of the money for rent for some time until we did receive some funding last year from the FBI to cover the base rent of the building. That's covered the rent through this year. However, that federal funding source, by all indication, is not going to reoccur at least this year. And I certainly probably wouldn't count on it in subsequent years. Chief McMillan is actively looking at other funding sources. I'm not in a position to say from what agencies or what level, but you know, both locally and at higher levels, he's looking at other funding sources to partnership to pay the base expenses. Another possible source of income that other task force generally see once they're up and running for a year or two is asset forfeiture funds. So we will have agreements in place with the local agencies, i.e. the sheriff's office, as well as DEA, ATF, FBI, for sharing of asset forfeiture funds, which we're fairly certain will be coming in at some point.
Quick follow-up, as a refresher, maybe Matt would know this, I'm not sure. The terms of the lease on that facility, what do we pay a month roughly, and are we on the hook for like 18 months, or was it like 5 years? I know they put a shower and they outfitted it. I mean, it was, we've got a lease, I think.
We have a lease. The base rent is $13,000 with all the tenant improvements that have been done, raises it to $17,000 a month. We have an opt-out option, and perhaps the city attorney can refresh my memory. I believe it's a 90-day opt-out. I'm not certain.
And then if we opt out, does the city attorney remember? I mean, I remember I was asking this lot. It's like $100,000 or something, right? We got to cough up because we have to pay for the tenant improvements if we opt out within a year or something. Or is this all foggy? If this is the weeds, Mayor, then we can get back to mowing the lawn, but I'm not sure, it's hard to get out. We're on the hook. Staff is obviously we're in a good position because we have money now, but what happens into 2013, 14 and beyond, it does not look like the federal dollars will be there.
And I think Chief McMillan is actively looking forward to that and trying to anticipate and make plans for some cost sharing of the thing. And I think, as you'll remember when you took the tour, what we've tried to emphasize is the benefit coming into this city, you know, literally
having
millions
staff.
Of dollars of labor that most of the time they're focused on the city of Salinas.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you, Steve. Councilmember Sanchez.
How many partners are still left? When I took the tour, it looked pretty empty to me.
There's quite a few more people there actively working now. DEA is down about half the time. FBI is there full time. ATF has an active presence and is currently very involved in some investigations with us. And Department of Homeland Security is actively involved in the center as well. And that's in addition to the huge commitment from the Monterey County Sheriff's Office. They've co-located two civilian staff, as well as their entire narcotics unit, as well as their participation in the gang task force.
What about from the state? Do we have anybody?
No.
Okay.
Tony, then Kimberly.
Mr. Presley, on the 50-50 with the sidewalks, with the $150,000, do we have, or is it Mr. Peterson? Mr. Peterson, do we have folks that are already involved? They're coming in and they're saying, hey, we like this.
Yes, we began at the beginning of the budget year and beginning to assemble the program. We now have 30 active applications. We have 12 completions, and word is spreading. So it's turning out to be a very successful program. We will be back after the first of the year, before the mid-year, with a full report on the sidewalk program. But right now, it's going very, very well. I think it's important to understand this is one of four sidewalk programs that we have. We also have the general fund sidewalk program that funds the repairs of the sidewalks that are on the ongoing 14-year list. We have the Rancho Cielo program where they have $75,000 a year, and we're now teaching them how to do handicap access ramps, because that's our greatest need and expands their awareness and understanding. So that's going very well. Partnership with our seasoned professionals working with the young men, that's going very well. And the other one is a CDBG funded citywide assessment so that we can develop our ADA program, which is partly defends us against lawsuits, some lawsuits, about ADA issues, because we're looking at what we can do to bring that up to speed. So those are the four programs. 50-50 is going very well.
Good, thank you. And just one other question on for Deputy Chief Mike Shorley. Thank you, Mr. Peterson. On the LEOC, so you're saying at this time, Chief McMillan is diligently working to looking for funding, but there's no sight in the crystal ball. The last time I heard about this issue was that the federal government is late, but they're going to come in and eventually pay us what they owe on this. And you're saying it's not happening anymore.
We're not counting on federal dollars. I mean, that could change, but we have no indication that that's going to occur this year.
Okay, thank you. And Mayor, as painful as this may be to you, I would like to request a separate vote once we do this. I would like to request a separate vote for the LEOC. Thank you.
Mr. Mayor, can I ask one quick follow-up of the Public Works Director on the 50-50?
Well, let me, you'll
okay.
get your chance.
Thank you very much.
Kimberly.
So I'll try hard not to get caught up in the weeds, but with 50-50. And just as a note, when you come back in January, one thing I would like to address is that we've received 30 applications. I was reading the staff report, and it says that there have been 2 to completion and 8 in process. And so I'd love to know kind of where the remaining 22 are, or just how successful that program is. I mean, my thing is, if we've got money allotted, and I think we have a deadline, if I'm not mistaken, in terms of, you know, 2 years that we're going to try out the 50-50 program, something along those lines. Are those 30 applicants in beforehand? And
there's an application process. So, I mean, I'll bring back a report on the full process, but it begins with staff meeting, evaluating, working with the homeowner, helping them select a contractor who does the work. So it's a very robust program. And then once it gets done, then we process the payment. So completion, but there are 30 in process right
That's
now
great.
With more added.
Okay. I must have misread then. I thought it was at 8 or something. And so, yeah, so I just come January when that report comes out, I'd love to know about how we're fast-tracking those people and getting as many people done as possible. Also, on the LEOC, sorry, you guys are playing tag. No need to respond. I just want you to know that I'm fully supportive of that funding. I've been out to the LEOC. I think I actually took a tour the same day that Councilman Sanchez and I made the same comment. I said, the place is empty. And my response was, the response that was given to me was, we knew you were coming, and so we needed to, you know, scatter. So everybody, no one was in the office when we actually toured it. But one thing I do want to note, and one of the things they said was, our funding for the LEOC is absolutely critical because we have federal agencies like the DEA who are able to help us in major, like, drug buys, where they can provide $10,000 for a drug buy, where our city cannot provide that. And so, understanding that and understanding that, I think that the Measure V committee certainly put forward an excellent recommendation. I plan to fully support it. One thing, Mr. Pressy, one question I do have, and this is actually just in kind of forecasting and reviewing, coming up in the mid-year budget review, one thing I would like to take a look at is salary schedules for the city manager position and the city attorney position. We have salary schedules for every other employee in the city of Salinas except for those two positions, and I think that that's fiscally responsible of us to look at that as an option. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Okay, Steve, Jill, Gloria, that's the
right. So the
all that with my eyes closed, so that's how I heard him and saw him.
No problem. So just very quickly for the Public Works Director, the whole 50-50 thing's brilliant. I'm so glad it's in place. There's a couple of ways to skin the cat. Because these people are technically giving the city money, I mean, they really are, do they get a friendly letter, you know, thanking them for paying half towards the sidewalk, when really we probably should have paid that. We should have paid that. They shouldn't be paying it. And in many respects, it should be just like as if you were going to give $3,000 to your favorite non-profitable, you know, charity or something like that, that has a tax ID number and thank you so much, signed by the mayor. And this gets back to this idea that the city is in effect through this 50-50 program incentivizing a donation to the city of Salinas. So is it a matter of, they write the check to us, we pay the contractor, or, I mean, how, it you is get
both.
What I'm getting at?
I do get what you're getting at, and we will begin to send thank you letters.
Perfect.
However, as you say, there are many ways to skin a cat, and actually, with the way the law is currently written, the entire cost of the sidewalk repair should be borne by the resident. That is the 1964 Highway Act. We do not, like most cities, have not enforced it for a very long time. So the effect of that is that it doesn't really in play, but that is the reality. However, I do agree with you, and we have had, I would say, very positive interaction between staff and residents that is helpful. We found to be very helpful with our residents understanding what it takes to do what we do. So
it's not a gift to
letters
the,
out.
It's not a gift to the city then, perhaps. I don't know. Consult your tax advisor or your favorite
city
finance director. Right.
Yeah. Okay. Jill.
I think my question is really for Matt. The health insurance increase was something that really was in my mind a big concern. Why is it that some of the northern California cities only have to pay the 9% and our region is a 16%? Do you know how those rates are set?
Yeah, and it's based on history and based on the region, and so the average for the whole state was 9%, so there were certain jurisdictions that were a lot less, and certain other places I've worked before getting the news of what the new rates were and having them be a lot less than the state average was a breath of good news. In this case, this is the largest increase that the city probably has ever received, period. And so I hope that answers your question.
Is there, are we working with other cities that have gotten that huge increase to see if there's ways that we can even out those, kind of like we did with the PERS rate, just even out that in kind of increase? And then the second half of the question is, why can't we have something like the police healthcare system that only increased 5%?
Yeah, definitely. If you know, healthcare costs is one of the big cost drivers in our budget, along with the pension, as far as a significant cost to the city. And the city historically has been part of a fund that, and I forget, I think it was a little more than 10 years ago, was part of a plan that was even more costly, and so we joined with the PERS healthcare and had a cost reduction. I think we need to keep all our eyes on this and look for alternatives of ways we can do it. Going with something that's more local, that is pooling other agencies locally, I think that's what we had, and that ended up being more costly. So what we can do to reduce that, I think that needs to continue to be monitored. We were not expecting that big of an increase. We budgeted 5%, and it came in at 16%.
Yeah, that, and historically, that was staggering.
This is stands out, and I would hope that that doesn't continue.
Okay, thank you.